Okay, everyone, good morning. Gonna get started. Welcome to our June Borough Board meeting. The first order of business is the adoption of the June 18th, today's Borough Board agenda.
Move to adopt.
Second?
Second.
Okay, thank you. All in favor? All opposed? Hearing none, the motion passes. Next, we have the adoption of the May 2015 Borough Board minutes. The minutes were emailed to you, and you also should have copies in the front if you need to see them. Do we have a motion to adopt the minutes?
Move to adopt.
I meant minor tweaks.
You made friendly amendments, tweaks?
Yes, okay, and nothing substantial, just so you
okay,
know.
Okay, and you have them on record?
On the record, right.
Okay, so motion to adopt the minutes has tweaked. So moved, a second. All right, all in favor? All right, all opposed? Hearing none, the motion passes. We're very excited about our presentation this morning. I know many of you have been eager to get the meat and content of this presentation. We have Sarah Goldwyn, Director of Planning Coordination at the New York City Department of City Planning, and who's actually come before the Borough Board in the past and has done, he's part of the Community Board Leadership Series, has conducted a variety of different trainings on the open data portal, on the community portal that they've created. So we're going to turn to her and she's going to introduce her team. But before that, I think I mentioned that for the benefit of the presenters, it's good if we can all go around and present ourselves so that she can know pretty much who's in the audience representing what capacity within the community board or council member portfolio. So we can go around and start with all right?
Hi, I'm Eric Stern. I'm stepping in for Vicky Barbero, the chair. I'm the chair of CB5's Land Use and Housing Committee.
Richard Lewis, CB12, the chair of the Housing and Human Services Committee.
Dolores Rubin, first vice chair, CB4.
Henrietta Lyle, chairperson of CB10.
Rick Eggers, first vice chair of Community Board 6, substituting for Sandra Sherrod.
Good morning, I'm Jim Kleins. I'm chair of Community Board 8.
Toby Bergman, chair of Community Board 2.
Bob Gormley, district manager, CB2.
Kathy McVeigh Hughes, chair, CB1.
Diana Sweetie, Director of Planning and Land Use, CB1.
Morris Chan from Anacor President's Office.
Sarah Goldwyn, Department of City Planning.
John Kaufman, also Department of City Planning.
Ralph Blessing, Department of City Planning.
Adam Amit from Councilmember Garani's Office.
Eric Botcher, Chief of Staff, Councilmember Corey Johnson.
Angel Muscain, District Manager, CB11.
Nelson Alamo, Community Board 11 member.
Mia Brazian, Assistant District Manager, CB11.
Lisa Prince, District Manager, CB9.
Lester Siegel, OMB.
Jay Gottlieb, OMB and City Planning.
Joe Nicola, OMB.
Peter Patch, a member of Community Board 8.
Nathan Thompson, District Manager, Community Board 8.
Andrew Sal, District Manager, CB10.
Honey Ryan, District Manager, Community Board 7.
Sam Levine from the Manhattan President's Office. Eli Senechash from the State Senator, Brad Wyman's Office.
Community Service, Corey Intern.
Charles Hanks.
Bo Pogo from the Borough President's Office.
Wally Rubin, Community Board 5.
Jessica Mates, Borough President's Office.
Jim Paris for the President's Office.
Matt Vigiano, Rosie Mendez's office.
Jesse Bodine, District Manager, City 4.
And we've been joined by Elizabeth Caputo, Community Board 7 Chair. Thank you. So without further ado, we'll get on to the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Aldrin, and thank you to the Borough President's Office for hosting us this morning. We're really excited to be here to share with you information on some improvements that we've been working on to improve the processes associated with the community district need statements and the borough budget. I want to do a quick introduction of our team here today. I'm joined by John Kaufman, who is our Chief Operating Officer at the Department of City Planning, and also by Ralph Blessing and Samantha Kleinfeld, also from City Planning, and then our colleagues from OMB, who are also joining us, Lester Siegel and Jay Gottlieb, and additional staff here from OMB. So we've got our full team here who's been working on this effort, and we're very glad to be here today. So I'm going to go through a a detailed presentation on this, and what I'd ask is that we hold all detailed questions until the end of the presentation, and we'll kick off from here. So, why are we here today? There are two main points here. The first is that we are going to introduce to you some improvements that we're making to the CD needs and budget requests. And the three main tenets of these improvements include that we are introducing a single integrated process for both of these elements that are related to the annual city budget process. The biggest improvement here comes around a new online submission form for collecting both the need statements and the budget requests in one piece. And our goal is that for you, these then result in more constructive dialogues with city government, with city agencies, with your elected officials, and also within your planning discussions at your board level. So I'm going to go through those changes at a level of detail, and then at the end of the presentation, outline the next steps for our rollout of these improvements and support that we have available to you as you go through this these changes for the first time. And I will say before getting any deeper into the presentation that these improvements are to processes that we all know have existed for many years, and that this is a first round of improvements that we expect will be incremental and improved over time based on your feedback and using them as a result of these initial improvements. So much of what we are aiming to do is responding to feedback that we've heard from both community boards and from city agencies on how these processes are working today. So I'll first focus on the left side of the screen and give you some overview of what we've heard from community boards in the past. The first is, who actually reads the community district need statements and what do they do with them? We know that many of you put a great deal of focus into these, and we're grateful for those of you who submit them on a timely and regular basis. But the question remains, how are they used? We've heard that from you that often they may or may not have been read in advance of the annual borough budget consultations in the fall. We also have heard that you don't necessarily get responses to them from city agencies, so why are we doing them? So that's one of the key pieces of feedback. The second is that preparing these statements is very time-consuming, and they're difficult to produce within constrained community board resources. We know we've heard from community boards that you all have varying levels of resources, both technologically and at a staff level, and it makes it very difficult to produce these statements on an annual basis, particularly because the schedules have been aligned with summer vacations. So we've heard you, and this is something we're looking to address as part of these improvements. The third is that the statements and budget requests don't receive meaningful consideration and responses from agencies, which is inherently why you're doing these statements and budget requests. So that's one of the things that we're looking to address with these improvements, and you'll see how in the details ahead. And then lastly, we've heard from community boards that you are looking to get better access to agency data and information and resources to inform your assessment of your community district's needs and budget requests. We certainly at City Planning have put a great deal of resources and energy into preparing our community portal. Can I see by a show of hands how many of you are familiar with the portal, have used it for preparing your statements? That's great. We've also heard that sometimes you have difficulty accessing information from other city agencies, and that there are additional things that you'd like to see from our agency. So this is something, too, that we're looking to better link to these improvements. So before going on to the agency's feedback, could I see by a show of hands if those four bullets are things that resonate with you? Yes. Seems like the majority. Is there any is there anything really important that we've missed? No?
Just yeah. One thought. Engagement with the how you can engage and reach out to the community in terms of helping them understand what's going on here as well.
how we, city planning, can engage with the community?
Well, you and in concert with community boards.
And how we engage with the community boards around preparation of their statements and budget requests, or on in response to them?
Engaging the community so the community has the process more visibility within the community if they're so interested.
Got it. So bringing more people into contributing to the needs assessments and development of a budget request. That's really constructive. Thank you. From agencies, we've heard that often these two processes seem disconnected. They've told us that they often receive the need statements and budget requests at different times, that they're not necessarily provided to them in a way that they're being considered at once, and so there's not that sort of broader context for understanding the specific budget request in the context of the needs assessment. Second, that the format of the statements vary widely, making it harder to understand the important issues. The need statements that we've seen and collected over the years range from a one-page cover letter to a two-page statement to a 35-page double-sided essay with complex charts and data supporting the information. So it's really interesting to see, you know, the differences in approaches that community boards put into these statements. And if you think about it from the agency's perspectives, they're then receiving very different products, and it's difficult for them in many cases to be able to pull out the salient information that's relevant just to their agency so that they can respond to you. The third bullet, the content's often not specific enough to action. Sometimes in those need statements, the narrative that is provided is at a high level, and so it's not giving them sort of specific examples or requests or needs that are actionable for them, and it's difficult to find. Fourth, the context or supporting data is often lacking, so it's hard to fully evaluate. A lot of times those statements are very qualitative, and they're not supported by fundamental quantitative data that helps them to really understand how it relates to their program and service areas. And then lastly, the information is often received too late to easily incorporate into the budget process. We're really pleased to receive 52 out of 59 statements last year citywide. And Manhattan gets the gold star from having all community boards participate. So that was amazing. Really amazing. And we thank you for your focus on this, and we think that with these improvements over time, that focus is going to pay off. Are there any burning questions on the feedback from agencies before I move on? Okay, yes.
Sometimes there's a coalescing of districts, so it's not clear that they would understand who has the greatest need versus others. So if you're in district, Councilman District 7, that covers two community boards. So again, that becomes a mishmash of needs and those kind of statements. In fact, I think that's been brought up before, and that it's not been clarified.
Thank you. And is that specifically related to the need statements or to the budget requests?
Well, both. If they're in the same districts, mm-hmm. they're going to say maybe dissimilar things, and there's no conjoining of the two.
Got it. If projects...
There's no prioritization of either, so how would you know?
Got it. Helpful. Any other...
Just one conversation. In terms of the gentleman's question,
yes.
I think most of the community boards has ways of basically interacting with the community. I know CB10 does, by basically posting the old one, giving everyone sufficient time to input. We also invite them to the committee meetings when this is laid out, and we've done just a great job of every meeting, having the books out so everyone can see it. So it's almost like a year process. But we also let the community know that they can come in, send in for any of the district need statements, let them review it, and then add on order.
That's great, that's a practice that I can't say we've heard that is sort of consistently held across the city and across the 59 boards, and encouraging consultation more broadly, both within community boards around your needs and budget request assessment, drawing in input from residents in your communities that aren't members of the community board is something we certainly want to encourage. And through this forum, we're hoping that you can use it as an interactive tool for bringing in those perspectives and recording them in this through this process. Thank you for that.
Just on your comment before, one thing we'll be asking for in the new form is for you to provide specific locations where things can be improved. So it will sort of force you to sort of give more information where we can action it and evaluate it fairly. So I think that will be there'll be a little more work to specify those places, but it will result in something that's a bit more of a fair evaluation by the agencies.
That's great. Yeah. I'm sorry, that's going to be a
mix. Yeah. Okay.
So, to reiterate some of the high-level goals of the changes, there are six here. First is to simplify the production process for the need statements and budget requests for you. It's pretty straightforward there. We want to, through this integration, we're going to simplify and streamline that for you. Second, we want to align those need statements and budget requests, the timeline for their production, with the city's budget process so they can be used more constructively to inform the conversations with city government and the responses that you receive as part of that process, which is not changing in terms of the timetable. Third, we want to make it easier for you to find access to resources, to data and information to inform your needs assessments. We are going to establish a format for more specific and actionable recommendations that are relevant to city agencies so that what they're receiving is something that they can, that is directly related to their service and program areas and have a higher probability of being able to respond to more specifically for you. So fifth, we want to support more substantive planning dialogues between city leaders and community boards. Ideally, this tool is something that you would then, once you've submitted it, be able to use for all sorts of different conversations with your leaders and agencies. And then in total, through these changes, we want to enable more efficient, responsive, and equitable decisions regarding service delivery and neighborhood and infrastructure planning. And certainly from city planning's perspective, we see that there's a great opportunity to be able to use these as a very strong foundation for the conversations that we have with communities around coordinated planning for neighborhoods in coordination with other city agencies. So we think that this will be a great tool for those discussions. So the four main changes to this process include the introduction of one online submission form for both the need statements and budget requests. There are four components to that new form. The first is a streamlined or overview of your district and general trends. So replacing that 35-page narrative with an introductory narrative about who you are and what your top issues are and what the general trends are that your district is facing in the upcoming fiscal year and times ahead. Second, we give you an opportunity to identify your most pressing needs by policy area. So for example, around parks and recreation and cultural facilities, what is your most pressing need related to those? Is it creation of new parks or improvements to existing parks? Third, each need will be identified and give you a direct link to choose a corresponding budget request. So the form will guide you in a way that enables you to select within categories of specific needs. We'll take that example of establish a new park in my district, and then it will give you a menu of specific budget requests that relate to that need. And I'll give you more details on this as we move forward, but these requests have been both vetted by city agencies and are representative of the most common requests that have been submitted by community boards in the past as part of the budget request process. So four, we want to support an easier ability for you all to specify specific locations for your requests, but down to the block and lot level and specific sites, and we'll give you tools to access that. So second, the form is pre-populated with about nearly 300 specific common agency requests, as I mentioned. And this reduces the obligation to describe that those requests in a long narrative. Though that information is important for agencies to hear, and you'll have an opportunity to include an explanation for these requests, but we're going to give you a very specific menu of requests to select from to make your path towards identifying those easier. Fourth, the form includes links to agency information and data resources right within the relevant section. So in within that Parks and Recreation section, we give you links to their agency's website, their capital planning resources, their approved budget for the last fiscal year. So you'll have access to all of that data right within the same section of the form that you're preparing your needs and budget requests for that agency's view. And then lastly, the completion of the form will automatically generate a summary for you and for city agencies. So that takes some of the formatting and production lift off of your plate. So you'll be guided through this instructed form, and at the end when you hit submit, you'll be able to have a document that you'll be able to both print and have in hard copy, and also have an electronic version to be able to share with your constituents and use for conversations with leaders. Yes?
I have a question. Sometimes when you're starting filling out an application, you can't go back the next day and fill it out. Mm-hmm. So your form is designed that you can keep submitting, adding to it, printing out drafts for editing.
It is.
And then
it is. Okay. The way it will work is that there will be a link that's distributed to all of you for you to incrementally fill out your form. You will be instructed to save your work as you go. It's important that as you go through it, you continually save your work. But there are also some backstops within the form so that you can't move away from it and all your work is gone. And there will also be features that enable you to track your progress. But the idea is, and especially in years to come, when that will give you access to this link much earlier in your business year so that you can be using it as part of your conversations that you have within your committees and within the community so that you can be incrementally filling it out over time, making changes and edits to it. And then submit it to us in time for our deadline.
Specific question about drafts.
Yes.
So you can see what it's going to look like before you finish the final submission, because you're submitting it in a way that is very difficult to then distribute to people and say, what do you think of this, and get their feedback. So if you can print out a draft of what the report looks like, you can get feedback and then make changes.
Let us look into that. We certainly are building it in a way that enables you to save your work as you go, to be able to print the screens to see what items that you have selected and be able to view your narrative. But that's
that
sounds like an important functionality for us to consider. Thanks for raising it. Yep.
Just a better explanation of the pre-populated areas.
Yes.
I assume that you have other areas for other things
we
that
do.
Are not pre-populated.
We do.
And what is the length of that?
Yes. There will be options within the form for you within each of those policy areas to select other. So, for example, we'll follow that parks example. We've got those most common requests, but then there's one. If you didn't see your request above, you can enter other, and then there's a pop-up window that gives you an explanation to describe what that other request is with that same level of specificity in terms of its location and explanation of the need. Yes.
This first time around, we've tried to do the best we can. This is going to be version one. And so we've really erred on the side of having a lot of opportunities for other. So if for some reason nothing is in here you want, you can use the other text box to write whatever you want overall. As you can imagine, for the agencies receiving it, it's a lot easier if it's a standardized, wording choice, and it kind of means something to them. And so we've worked a lot with the agencies to say, what is a list that will mean something to you, and compared that to what previous committee boards have submitted. So we've tried to get a list that will work for everybody, and so we're trying to, hopefully the list of 300 things will pick up 98% of what you want. But if we miss a lot, there's this other sort of safety net for the whole thing. But really try to use the choices, and we'll try to learn from you as to what we've missed in doing this. The same for the functionality. We're trying to get all the user functionality built into the tool this first time around under a lot of time crunch to get this out. So it probably is not going to be perfect this year, but it's going to be a lot better and a lot easier for you all.
Yes.
Just piggybacking on your comments, so if you've already hoped that the canned pull-downs are going to be ones that the agency has recognized, when you get to other, a lot of times what happens is the language is going to be different. It isn't going to fit in with the style of the other ones. Is there a way that your programming could actually create so that the other is the first thing that goes to the agency? Because it's not going to fall into what they're already looking for to say, oh, I understand that, check.
Well, I think, again, we need to, part of this is going to understand how many others there are. The agency is going to get a report that's so much easier than when they get now that it's going to make their lives in many ways easier. Because right now they're basically reading all the others. And there's, you know, hundreds and hundreds of those from 59 community boards they're going through. So this is going to be a lot easier for them, and we'll make the other very prominent to them. You may decide that your other is actually not even, you know, very low on your priority list, and so we wouldn't want to put that the first thing they see if it's actually the 40th request you have. So we'll make sure that we're not going to lose that because we're really sensitive to the fact that we may be missing the others, but it's not something we're going to over-rotate on because we feel like there's some chance it's not going to matter. If the others are all like numbers 1, 2, and 3, we're going to make sure that they get that the right way.
Do you think there would be a way to prioritize if your other happens to be one of your lead? Because obviously you mentioned in the first section you were talking about your top priorities by policy.
Yes, yes. And moving forward, I'll give you an example of how we prioritize and what point in the process that happens. I'm going to take one last question before moving on,
I just want to on the coattails of the draft part, is that at least for a lot of boards, this is a public document.
Yep.
And so therefore we ask, you know, we put this up as public notice like with all the other documents. So we have to have that ability to be able to print out a final, you know, draft version of it and be able to put it on our website and say, please comment on this because we're going to be voting on this at a full board in 5 or 10 days. And so just printing out the screens individually will be very difficult.
Right.
I think we need to have that last backstop of being able to say, you know, all ready, set, go, not yet, press print and draft, print out the whole thing, treat it as a PDF, put it on our website, and then people can comment on it.
Yes. You will definitely have the ability once you've completed your draft submission to print it and use it for those purposes. What we're going to look further into is the feasibility of printing a formatted version of it in progress, which is, I think, what your question was. Right, sir?
Well, if it's still a draft that you can go back and change, it's still in process, so that's fine.
Right. Okay. So moving on. And this is also equally important in terms of what's not changing. So there are all these improvements we're making, but there are some things that will remain the same this year. First being the borough budget consultations that are led by OMB. And Jay and Lester, who are here today, are key organizers and coordinators of that process. That process is not changing, including the timetable. You've already received your request for agenda items. The agenda setting process is the same. And the schedule for the publication of the register of requests and responses is not changing. So second, there will still be a need to prioritize the capital and expense budget requests within OMB's schedule, but that will happen after the fall budget consultations. The budget consultations, as you all, I believe, are familiar, take place just after Labor Day and run through the middle of October. After those, you'll be asked to prioritize your needs and requests. The thought there being that The draft form that you're submitting, and as you can see here in the third bullet, the due date is August 10th. After you've submitted that draft form, you'll be able to use it for the conversations at the borough budget consultations. And then following those conversations, you'll be asked to reassess the budget requests that you identified in your draft needs statements and then prioritize them before submitting them by October 30th. Which is consistent with OMB's current deadline for submission of your prioritized budget requests. Any questions on those dates? Yes.
The August 10th day would be district needs.
Together.
With budget requests as of at August 10th.
Correct. Draft.
Unprioritized.
Just the requests that you've identified with your needs.
Can additional budget requests be identified up until then, October 30th?
Yes.
Okay, so if new items come in based on what the consultations bring out and other conversations, we have until October 30th to bring everything into the final document.
Correct.
And the thinking there is that you'll learn something in the borough consultations that say, I really want to make this number one, I want to get their attention, versus I understand now why this one isn't going to work, I'm not going to prioritize it, for example.
Okay. Just what's the purpose of the draft submission?
It's primarily to enable you to use that document for the conversations that you're having with agencies at the budget consultations in the fall. So that's the intent for community boards. For agencies, it's enabling them to have an earlier look at your needs assessment and your budget requests as they prepare for A, responding to you, and B, preparing their own departmental submissions for their budget requests earlier in the budget cycle.
I had such a burning question. It may be the wrong time. Do they really read? I mean, everything has been rubber stamped. Their responses have always been kind of rubber stamped. So, I mean, we're going through a lot of work here, and I would love to get to the point, what does the agencies actually do with this
exactly.
information? And is it just rubber stamped? Or
exactly.
I don't know if anyone has ever gotten a yes, there's money coming through, and we may have missed that because we probably didn't get that far down.
Yeah.
But I just love to hear.
You've hit on the core of it.
Okay.
You've hit on the core of it. And we've met with dozens of representatives from the primary city agencies that respond to the needs and budget requests. And you heard from us earlier in the presentation what some of the challenges are that they've faced in years past in reviewing these and responding to these. And we've tailored this form in a way that both is supporting you, but also supporting them in their evaluation, which hopefully will lead toward their easier evaluation and communications with you and better responses. We're also working to reevaluate a palette of responses, if you will, that for agencies that will be more specific for you. So even if the answer is no, we don't have funding due to resource constraints in this year's budget, there's a reason behind it that's a little bit more specific than talk to your local elected official, for example. So we're looking at that palette and trying to get that better for both sides.
But, I mean, and I think to your and Jay and Lester, you may speak up also in terms of what. I think every agency has a different process for what they do with this, and one thing we're trying to do is standardize what they get. You know, we're not going to give them more money overnight to respond to some of these things. You know, there's still going to be some things on their side that they need to process, but it gets a lot more transparent what actually you need and why it's important to you through the information we're asking you to provide here. So I think that, there's a lot of different approaches with the different agencies. They all receive the forms, but the mandate of what they do with it is complicated by just the different format that they get so far. So I think this will be a big step forward, but it may not change the purse size, but it will be a step forward in transparency. I don't know if Jay or Lester, you guys want to add anything to how you've observed the agencies work with the responses?
Well, I've got, a contact that I distribute the requests to, and, I'm not privy to what they do with it internally, but, I assume that different agencies have distributed it internally in different ways. Some, perhaps, given it to the right people to review and respond to, and in some cases, perhaps the people who should be reviewing and responding to them never saw the request that is possible.
And part of this reform was to sort of get all those people in the room and say, what will make it more useful for you and make you able to respond to these more easily? And so we've designed it with them in mind, again, as much as we have it designed with you all in mind. So we know in the end, what you really want is action from them more than kind of produce this document for internal purposes.
And I would also say that back to my initial comment about, both the rollout of these improvements being incremental, we know that these are longstanding processes that, and the reforms that we're looking to initiate now will take time to take hold and for agencies to both see the improvements to the input that you're giving them, and there will likely be some time and learning curve for them in terms of realigning their evaluation processes and response processes in a way that becomes more meaningful. Hopefully we see some of those benefits in the short term, and that will help both to inform how the form is structured and how you all interact with it. But I think that's something that we hope will evolve and improve over time as a result of this.
And as you finish the J. Gottlieb O&B, as you finish preparing the agendas for the fall consultations while you're doing this, please, you know, make your questions as sharp as possible. Because what we're hoping to do is, with all these things going on, to make the fall budget consultations much more of a dialogue rather than and much more substantive and result in improvements in the whole response back and forth between you all and the agency.
Great. I want to move on to make sure we get through the rest of the presentation.
You may be going to this, but I might may have missed this. Is this a two-way process where the streamlining for responses is also addressed on your end, or this is just streamlining the input process?
The streamlining of responses is something that we're going to look to address within the regular non-changing annual cycle of the OMB responses. But it is baked within these improvements, but it's a later part of the process following your submissions. So we'll next focus on how we're going to support you, and just I want to make a note on that last bullet related to the responses to requests. We know that the agencies are still not going to be able to fund everything that they're asked to fund, but with the more specific details, they'll be able to better consider them. So a brief overview of the new form. There are 10 sections. The first two are basic fundamental information about your community board, its composition, and contact information. There will be opportunity for you to provide a district overview with a narrative and identification of your most pressing issues. And on the left and the right-hand side of the screen are the agencies relevant to the sections that that you're completing. Sections 3 through 9 are the key policy areas, and they're organized around the main service and program delivery areas provided by the relevant agencies to the right. And then the 10th section is the instructions on your submission. So this last page on key dates and support contacts, and you do not need to take notes. I've got a handout for you that has all of this information on it, so you can focus on the slide. The key dates to the left are Friday, June 26th, a key date for us as well. We are aiming for this to send out the link to the new form for the draft online submission for your integrated needs and budget requests. So keep your eyes peeled for that. In July, we're going to offer another information session. You'll receive information on that, and we're making that available to all community boards. In August, on the 10th, is your due date for your draft submission form, which gives you about 6 weeks to prepare your statements and budget requests. Hopefully your work has already commenced on your need assessment and thinking about your budget requests, so you can use this form just to collect your thoughts. A key point in the fall is the Borough budget consultations, again sticking with the same schedule from previous years, led by OMB, will be held following Labor Day through the mid-October. The key point for you to focus on is following your Borough budget consultation is when you'll go back, review your draft, and complete the prioritization of your budget requests. We will be sending you instructions for how to do that in the fall, but it will roughly look like you'll be able to receive the collection of all of the budget requests that you received, and you'll be able to basically click and drag them into the order that is relevant to your prioritization. So we're looking to make that as easy and visually streamlined as possible. And then that deadline is for submission of your final needs and requests is October 30th. Which is the same time frame that OMB has used in the past for collecting your requests. That has not changed. So then, once you have your final submission made, you'll then be able to, again, have a link to it and the hard copy of your statement complete. And then between now and between that point and the beginning of 2016, we're going to do a lot of analysis on our ends of all of the need statements and budget requests and prepare report summaries on our community portal, both at the community district level within your district's portal page, and then we're also going to look at borough and citywide comparisons, which we think are going to be really interesting and informative for community boards and elected officials and the general public and city agencies that are engaged in planning conversations with you all. That's an area where we're really excited about being able to look at trends over time as the data continues to come into us. Those submissions of the needs and budget requests will be used by OMB in publishing the agency responses at the same time in mid to late January is the target for the preliminary budget register. Those are key dates. And then on the right-hand side of the screen is our agency support. So we've listed contact information from both our planning team and planning coordination, Marlon Anderson. I'm sure many of you are familiar with working with Marlon in the past and submitting your needs statements. We've included his contact information here and our general team email address. And I've also included here OMB's contact information for both Lester and Jay, who are here today. If you have questions related to the planning considerations as you're developing your needs statements and requests, our borough office liaisons are available to you. And the Manhattan office liaisons, I'm sure many of you are familiar from your day-to-day board activities, but their contact information is available on our website. And I've also included a link to our community portal here, which provides a wealth of information for preparing your form. So with that, I'm happy to take any questions.
Questions, comments? Let the record show, too, that we've been joined by Community Board 11 Chair Matthew Washington, Community Board 3 Chair Gigi Lee, and Community Board 9 Chair Reverend Morgan Thomas. And with that said, we have a question.
Sure. Just in terms of the prioritization, I mean, as you articulated, there's sort of a couple of canned responses that we get which sum up to, we're broke, ask the council member for money. How does the prioritization work? How is that really considered in terms of, you know, what does number one priority look like versus a number 15 priority? How is that handled when it goes to the agency? The agency, they know the priority level? I mean, I'm just curious internally how the priorities are dealt with.
Yes, Jack, go.
Can I suggest that this question be posed directly to the agencies in the fall consultation? Put it on your agenda, who's ever preparing the agenda. Thank us here. Is that okay? I point you out? Because we haven't met yet, but I heard you introduce yourself. Latha's coordinating the preparation of all the agendas for Manhattan. So different people, she's working with all of you to prepare the different agendas. But that's a question that should be posed directly to the agencies and have them talk to you and have a dialogue about it in the fall budget presentation.
So you're delivering it to them as, here's Community Board 11's number 3 priority?
Yeah, I'll address that as it's...
What's the delivery to the agency?
As it's been traditionally done. In the past, we've had the complete access databases with the request, and one field is to give it a priority. All of the information that you put into the access database, the request and the priority, has been transmitted to the agency. So the short answer is yes, the agencies have received the priority that you've given in, that you've given the request. I cannot, unfortunately, tell you internally how the agencies are considering your request vis-a-vis the priorities that you've given.
So what I'm suggesting is you ask the question to the agency in the fall, like, how are you considering the priorities that we specified for this area? And that should be an easier question to ask with these new need statements printed out, that they won't have the priorities in them, but you can ask them specifically, what does this mean to you, and how can you be more effective in communicating our needs?
Sure.
And that would be a very meaningful part of the fall consultation. The agencies are there, put them on the spot.
Sure, but wouldn't OMB also be able to request from the agencies that information and circulate it to all community boards?
It's something we could try. We can ask different agencies for their policies in terms of their review of the requests and specifically how they're looking at the priorities given to those agencies. So we can try and get back as much feedback as we can from the agencies.
We'll take four more questions.
And I mean, just to close this out, I know you're probably a little dissatisfied with the answer so far. I think
not dissatisfaction, just a request. I mean, I think OMB is saying, hey, how are they being considered? Because if agencies are saying, we just look at all the requests and we see if we can do whatever we can, maybe the prioritization isn't as important as just getting the information in there, or maybe they are considering the numbers.
Yeah. Well, and I think what they're saying is, every agency kind of does it do differently. There's no single way how to treat the priorities. And so I think Jay's idea of actually putting it on the table and saying, what will you do with it, will get you more color around that answer. I think to Sarah's point, we can assure you that what they're getting in this next packet is going to be much better organized for them to actually do something with it. And we're going to make the prioritization very clear in the output they get, in addition to the access database. So I think that it will be more meaningful after this year. And so whatever they say is probably going to be different than how they'll handle it this next year. But they are, we are continuing to ask for the prioritization. We encourage you to take that very seriously, because if it's not prioritized, for example, I think it's not going to get the same request. And we're thinking about things like, let's make sure the top 10, things really pop in the report. And we're trying to make sure that those things carry extra weight. What they do with it in the end is still up to them. That's, that's the agency's right. But we're going to try to make it very clear what's the most important for you all by having some leading questions that really make them sort of confront what is the most pressing issue in different community boards. Mm-hmm.
Okay, have one, then Henrietta.
So, I think part of what you're hearing is a certain sense that this is an exercise and it doesn't really have much of an impact on the budget. So I know and I agree that it's the agency's right to make its budget decisions. What I think would be really valuable, and this should make easier, is if on an annual basis the city looks back at what was the responsiveness of the agency on an agency-by-agency basis to this process. So, you can't force their hand, but you can, a year later, look back and say, well, was the budget responsive to the process? Was the actual spending responsive to the process? And that then tells us whether or not this is just a more streamlined portion of a way to engage in a basically useless process, or whether there is a real meaning to it. So I what I'm saying is, I think that to make all this great work, and I think it's really good, have meaning, you have to commit yourself to each year doing an analysis to see if it had meaning.
And for us, what we're trying to make it easier for the agencies to evaluate it, but also, make sure that you have an opportunity to provide supporting data so they'll evaluate it more. I think, a lot of it comes with enough substance behind the requests that are linked to things that are on the portal and other places other information the agency has, so that it feels like a substantiated request. The fact that you guys are requesting in the first place should be enough in many cases. I mean, you're in touch with the communities, you're out there. But I think we're trying to say, if the more data that you can put in there to help them understand it, you may get a better outcome. And I think the budget consultations will be more meaningful because of this process ahead of time, and that we're talking a language that they will understand more and putting you in a position to do it at the right time in their cycle.
I think the substantiated data piece is really important, because something we've heard from agencies is that they often get the same list of prioritized requests from community boards year after year after year. So it's hard for them to ascertain whether they still really are the priorities, or if the community boards have heard the responses and are actually critically evaluating how they've prioritized their needs and requests in a way that are being responsive to the answers they've gotten in years past.
Just one point, and almost like, I guess, in defense of the register document that we used. I mean, I think your question has two points. One is, you know, has anyone looked at the responsiveness? And two is, if someone were looking at the responsiveness, is anyone reacting to the fact that there's very little responsiveness? Okay. To the second point, I don't have the answer to that. To the first point, we have a chart. We have traditionally had a chart in the introduction of the register that everyone receives, not only the boards, but the council members and borough presidents. And of course, it's on all of these websites, so it's you know, a public document. A chart which shows the number of requests submitted to each agency and a percent that received a positive response. And you can see in that chart, the percent of positive responses is very low. Agencies have complained to us that they don't like that chart being in the register because it makes them look bad. We have to remove it.
Great.
Henrietta?
My question,
and then we have Max, and then
I'm on the same wave here. About 4 years ago, at a Borough consultation, EDC sent the lowest level person to the Borough consultation. It was an embarrassment. We actually called the agency. We had the head of the agency come to our EC meeting because we realized that they were not really serious. So I just asked our district manager here in terms of how is that working now. Well, they're sending individuals, the equivalent of the district managers, which is really great, but they can't answer a lot of the questions. And they said, give us this in writing, we'll take it back, and then they may get approximately 50% answers back. So again, I don't see, this is great work, but I don't see the seriousness of the agencies really listening to community boards. And you know, when we talk about, yes, the same priorities may be in there, it's because we're still trying to seek those priorities, you know. But again, I mean, many years ago, I got a letter back from public library, and I said, oh, I found the file. I said, my God, they do respond. This is great. I was so excited. I sent the letter all around. Someone said, stop. This letter comes every year. And it's the same letter, you know. It's the same letter. And I said, I was a little embarrassed. Because I was so excited that the public library responded, but then it's the same letter. So that's why I said we do so much work, and I have never seen a positive response yet to anything, you know. So that's my concern. Do the agencies really take this seriously? And I would love, I know there's a lot of city agencies, can we find out their processes to how this gets to the wire? They come back to us and tell us, no, see your city council, no money this year. What's the process? I know that would take a lot of work, but they should give us this information. I mean, this is a lot of work that we're putting out as community boards. You know, in our community, they just don't believe in this process.
And in our consultation that we had with agency leaders, we started with very high level decision makers. I think that is an absolutely fair question, and I think it's key to making these reforms actually reform these processes. So I think in part the response that we've given in terms of trying to figure out how we can get you information on what those processes are is something that we'll look into. And then there's definitely some work to be done in terms of circling back with the agencies about how they're engaging in the borough budget consultations and then in actually carrying out their end of these processes, which, as I mentioned before, I would imagine will happen incrementally over time. But putting this in place that is responding to some of the feedback that we've heard from them also, I think, is a strong starting point for starting to, you know, make change to these processes. So
thank you
for your feedback.
Here. And then the last question.
Yeah, I think this process, the new process, sounds excellent. And I would just say that the community portal right now has been really great for us. I just have two, or I guess three, quick, I guess, asks maybe moving forward. I think one is, it's hard to figure out exactly which properties in a community district have regulatory agreements through HPD. And sort of putting copies of all of the regulatory agreements in the community portal and sort of like a New York City or New York State subsidized housing, I think could be really helpful for us to better understand some of the housing characteristics in a community district. Right now you can get it from ACRIS, but it's kind of, it's it's very time consuming, and it's hard if someone goes to the community board and says, where's the affordable housing in the district? It's hard for us directly to pinpoint exactly what is where. I think another thing is the HVS right now. I know you guys have housing characteristics based on the American Community Survey.
Right.
But if it would be possible to take some of the HVS information and put it in the community portal, I know right now I think some of that's broken down at the sub-borough area and that there may be issues of breaking it down to the community district. But I think the more information we have on housing characteristics in the district, the better. And then the third is on the DHS hope count. You know, we've asked DHS in the past to better, we want to understand sort of what their findings are at the community district level or something below the kind of Manhattan borough level. And to the extent that city planning and OMB could try to get us some of that information, it would be tremendously helpful. Because right now we have a really hard time understanding exactly what is going on the streets.
Let us take a look into those three points. Thanks.
Three great points. And then the last question will come.
Sure. I guess I was just curious how this is going to work into the city council's budget process. So the boards do all this work to let the agencies know, and then are the agencies then bringing that to us during the hearing, the executive budget hearing process, sort of helping us to sort of figure out how we're going to help achieve sort of the goals and priorities that the boards are setting? Because I'll be honest, I don't think that those documents are much part of what comes to us from agencies when we're going through our budget process.
I'll say that these documents will be available, you know, in their draft and final forms publicly once they're completed, and so they're certainly accessible to the council, and they're intended to be used more broadly to support the conversations that all stakeholders have within the budget cycle. And so hopefully as they become more constructive and relevant documents to community boards and to agencies, they can be a supportive foundation for conversations that are happening with the council. It's not changing any of the sort of process that you all partake in, but it should be better input into that process.
And as far as the register production in terms of what we've done up until now and what we will continue to do, we have an interface in our computer system of council districts and community boards, and we produce a council district register 1 through 51, and council district register 1 has the community boards that are in council district 1. And we email to each of the 51 council members their specific register. So we have all the requests of the community boards that are in their council district. And we will continue to do that.
Customizer. Thank you.
Thank you. And we'll be pressed for time, but thank you so much for your presentation.
Great.
And at the very least, I think these processes definitely heighten accountability. And having those 300 or something different budget categories in there, I think, will help streamline this tremendously.
Excellent. I'm circulating a handout, which is the support contact page and the summary of the main benefits of the changes. You've got our contact information on there. I'll stick around for a few minutes afterwards.
And also, June 30th, you're going to dig into the actual online application?
No, on the 30th, we'll be back here to make a presentation on our city planning resources, but we will be talking about how those resources can feed into your preparation of the statements and budget requests.
We have the PowerPoint. We can circulate that if that's fine.
We might wait until we have a final version.
Okay.
We'll send something out on the 26th.
Okay.
I mean, this page, I think, is fine. We want to make sure.
There's just the other details. I mean, this is a nice calendar, but if we can,
we'll get you that with the link.
That'd be great. But
okay, everyone. Now we're gonna go on to community board updates. Community board chair reports. We'll start with community board one.
Oh yes, definitely. June has been another.
Everyone, quiet, please. Quiet.
Good morning, everybody. Community Board 1 has been another very busy month. Helicopters seem to lead the issue. As you know, there was a helicopter that took off at the North Cove Marina and Battery Park City in Battery Park City. CB1 wrote a letter to the FAA, the Federal Aviation Administration, inquiring about this helicopter takeoff from the North Cove in Battery Park. Both the Battery Park City Authority issued a statement saying that this will not happen again, but we still want to make sure we find out why FAA approved this. Helicopters, again, Pier 6, we've been on the record multiple times in 2007, 2009 in resolutions, again in last year's Governor's Island testimony about our concern for Pier 6. So what happened is when the West Side back in 2010 decided no longer to take tourist helicopters, it consolidated all the helicopter activity into Community Board 1 on Pier 6. And so with the resurgence of Lower Manhattan, particularly an investment in the East River Promenade, Governor's Island, the Battery, there can be up to 8 to 10 helicopters taking off and landing at any particular moment. New York City EDC says there are 50,000 takeoffs, 50,000 landings, so that's 100,000 per year, and I know we've had many complaints from many other community boards, so we passed the resolution in our financial district committee that's going to go to our full board. We'd love to work with any other community board that's concerned about this ongoing issue that has not gotten resolved, but in fact has gotten worse. It is a safety concern, particularly with the large skyscrapers in our community. They are also, we have lots of national parks, which is very important because that's involved with FAA. And it's a major quality of life issue dealing with both noise and air pollution as well. So it's just a matter of time until there's another accident. Okay, South Street Seaport, no new information on the Howard Hughes revised plans for mixed-use project, including the proposed residential tower on the new market building site. We provided a timeline. We've been working very closely with our elected officials for the last 3 years through many meetings, and including the Seaport Working Group. Resiliency continues to be a top priority downtown. We're waiting to hear back about the RFP from the city. We understand that it's supposed to go out sometime this summer, but would like to find out more about it. So any help we can get from the Borough President's office and Councilmember Chin's office would be greatly appreciated. For the first time, we actually have an emergency center that's been approved by the Office of Emergency Management. So we'd like to thank Trinity Church St. Paul's, which is very exciting. As you all know, hurricane season just started, so we want to make sure everybody knows your zone. Today is the kickoff for River to River. It's free events. There are roughly 60 in 11 days between June 18th and June 28th, so we encourage everybody to come since it's free for everybody. On another note, a little bit more seriously, the 9/11 Memorial Museum, I attended, I'm on the World Trade Center stack. We had a tour of their health component of the museum, so we also passed a resolution that will go to the full board on Tuesday, asking that the 9/11 Memorial Museum beef up or really focus more on the personal sacrifices due to the environmental health impacts at the 9/11 Memorial Museum. It's very limited, it's very small, and a lot of information has been learned, and it needs to reflect that, particularly now as we're fighting for the James Hadroga bill. And another event I just want to make sure that you all know about is the Hermione Lafayette is going to be landing at the Pier 15, and it's a beautiful historic boat reconstructed for the July 4th weekend from July 1st through July 4th. And we just want to make sure that people are aware that you know, there's more than Nathan's hot dog eating contest for July 4th at actually Lower Manhattan, where a lot of our history started. It's very important. And Community Board 1 will hopefully be moving in July to 1 Center Street on the 22nd floor. Thank you very much.
Kelly,
Community Board 2.
Toby had to step out, so I'll give the report. Just one item I want to bring to everyone's attention. On Tuesday, June 30th, from 10:30 a.m. until 3:30, we're hosting a Senior Action Day. There's going to be representatives from a large number of not-for-profits, businesses, and agencies to talk about their programs and services and information that would be valuable in for seniors. Our social services committee has been doing a lot of work to organize this. It's being co-sponsored by the LGBT Center and SAGE. And I spoke to Morris about it yesterday. I'll send you guys a flyer. I'll send all the boards a flyer because I have a feeling there are probably senior citizens living everywhere. So that's it.
I'm going to go out of order for a second. Community Board 7.
Sorry, I think I've only done this once in my whole tenure. Just two quick things because I have to go to work for something at 10. We have had a lot of issues with City Bike. We came to the last Borough Board meeting and talked about how we did our first sighting locations and did a meeting on looking at all the locations between 59th and 110th Street. Our second meeting this past month focused on safety and infrastructure. We had, again, great turnout. I think for the most part, people were very supportive. We did have a number of concerns about several of the locations, which DOT is taking up. Brings me to my second point, which deals with data. And I would love to try to communicate with the other community boards and the Borough President's office on convening a meeting with DOT of where data is coming. I feel like everyone is getting data, whether it's crash data or any sort of safety data, transportation-related data. It's coming. We're all getting it from different sources, whether it's the PD or other places. And whether it's a representative from the PD or a representative from DOT or both, I think there could be a lot of value in hosting something here and sending a representative from each of our boards rather than them coming to each of our boards and telling us something that may or may not be consistent. So that's a huge sort of priority of ours. And then I guess the final thing is just that we continue to work on our Inclusive Playground Task Force, which is really taking off and is a model that we hope we can replicate throughout other community districts as well. And that information is all on our website. So that's it for me. And I really appreciate your patience. I'm sorry I have to leave early.
Thank you. Okay. Community Board 3.
Thanks. So CB3 hosted a fundraiser for the small businesses affected by the Second Avenue fire and explosion, and I'm excited to announce that we raised over $3,000, so we're very excited for that event. We also, the Land Use Committee and kind of working with HPD, realized that we had some confusion over the process and the role of Community Board in commenting on inclusionary housing applications throughout the area. So we have requested to get a training specifically on how the Community Board can be most impactful in that process. So if that's something that interests you guys, perhaps you guys can also request that you have a similar presentation. We also got a presentation on the new ferry stop that's coming in on Grand Street, part of the mayor's kind of making New York City more ferry friendly as another mode of transportation, which was very informative. And then lastly, I think many of you have read that in the papers that recently there have been attacks on Asian, targeted towards Asian women. Most recently one in the middle of the afternoon, right near Columbus Park in Chinatown on Mulberry Street, and then also one in Little Italy. So I know the Councilmember Chin has been out flyering, asking just people to be not, you know, the community is very upset and kind of worried about. So that's my update.
Community Board 4?
Hi. So Community Board 4 has been working for a very long time on our affordable housing plan, which we voted on at this month's meeting, and we're finalizing the document. It will be available on our website. It's a very long process. We're very proud of it. In answer to the questions about where there's availability, there's very detailed information in this report in our district where there are units, the type of units. So that may be a model for some of the other community boards to try to figure out how we can gather this information, because it is helpful for the whole city, I think. In terms of, in the same topic of affordable housing, we've been very busy working with EDC on a couple different areas. Slaughterhouse is a site that is city-owned, and also with the Covenant House, who is looking to build a new home. So these are opportunities for us to have more affordable housing in our district, and we're working with HPD and EDC and had several meetings over the last few months, and it looks like things are moving very positive, and we're hoping soon we'll be able to talk about some successes in that area. In terms of some issues in CB4, there's been an increased reporting of illegal building permits being issued and people being displaced because of these building permits, which do not seem to be on the up and up. It's something we're starting to look into. We're looking perhaps with some of the agencies to help us figure out exactly what's going on and see if we can help some of these potentially displaced tenants that are fighting that right now. One of the things that we, just piggybacking on CB7's talk about data, 311 is something that continues to come up as we try to streamline our processes for the Community of Life Committee on how to go ahead and get things taken care of. We're realizing there are a lot of categories that don't quite fit or that either go to the wrong place, the response that comes back isn't appropriate because it's not categorized correctly. And what we're hoping is maybe the Borough President's Office can help us get a meeting together with DOITT to try to focus on how to improve 311 even more. It's an incredible opportunity to have something like 311, but it continues to fail us in some ways as we become more technical savvy as a society and need to be able to specify a little bit more about what the concerns are. And lastly, in conjunction with the Borough President's Office, we're going to be hosting the Small Business Roundtable on July 8th. This is great because it fits in with what we've been working with in terms of trying to create a little bit more of a mixed-purpose business environment. Our corridors in Chelsea and in Hell's Kitchen along 9th Avenue continue to be heavily bar inundated, and what we're hoping is to try to find some balance there. We do have a task force that works on the balance, and this will work well to try to figure out how mom and pops and other small businesses can stay alive as we continue to see the big boxes come in, more Duane Reads, more Chases, and more bars, because they're the only ones that can afford these rents. So that's something we're very happy to work with the Borough President.
Community Board 5.
So we are coming toward the end of the East Midtown Steering Committee process, being led by the Manhattan Borough President and co-led by the Manhattan Borough President and Councilmember Gorodnik. It's been an exciting sort of experience, a lot of meetings around this table, and I think we're getting very close to a resolution, which we're a set of recommendations to city planning, which we're excited about, to both help existing landmarks, really urge LPC to designate kind of those properties that are worthy of designation, but then also enabling those properties to, you know, still get value by transferring their unused development rights to facilitate new Class A commercial development. I've never done one of these reports before, but, you know, one thing that we have been looking at is the R10 program in our community district, and, you know, we have all these, you know, luxury towers going up on 57th Street that are, you know, able to get bonus at this ratio of like 1 square foot of affordable housing to 3.5 square feet of bonus. And it just like looks, you know, I understand, you know, in the 1980s how that may have made sense. But in today's market, just it seems as though it's not at all sort of leveraging private development in a way that serves the public sufficiently. And so we are working to figure out exactly how best we can change that to get more affordable housing in our district to preserve socioeconomic diversity moving forward.
Thank you. Community Board 6.
Over the summer, we've got mostly land use issues to deal with. Interestingly, we have, similar to Board 5, we have a new super tower being proposed in the Sutton Place area, mid-block. It would be a 90-story building. It is in an R10, so we share some of the same issues that Board 5 has been dealing with for quite some time now along 57th Street. So we'll need to be dealing with that, because right now we don't know how to stop it because it's as of right, and we have to look at all sorts of zoning issues and proper responses. We did note Board 5's potential moratorium on such construction and may join in with you on that kind of approach. We have a sanitation garage being proposed at 28th and 1st Avenue that the community is still quite upset about. The scoping hearing is next week. We're getting complete pushback from EDC and sanitation about the concept of having a sanitation garage there at all, which is what the community is opposed to. EDC and sanitation are proposing interesting options for the two sides around the sanitation garage, but their assumption has always been that the sanitation garage is going to be there whether the community likes it or not.
So we'll see what happens at the scoping hearing next week. We have one piece of property that is a privately owned public space that was granted as part of a restrictive declaration on the construction of the property in 1981. The current owner proposes to put a commercial space in that public space, which we believe to be granted in perpetuity as open space. The commissioner of city planning is prepared to sign approval for this commercial space, and we have absolutely no recourse at this point. It's entirely under the discretion of the commissioner. There is a substantial move within our board that this is totally inappropriate. It eats away at the whole concept of a restrictive declaration in the first place. But we're not quite sure where that's going to go. If anyone has any suggestions on what next steps we might take on when the commissioner has sole discretion to move, we don't see that there is anything that we really have a recourse to. So we're going to be busy over the summer with those issues. Thank you.
Thank you. Community Board 8.
Good morning. Jim had to leave early. We introduced 10 new board members in May, and we introduced our 11th at our last night, our June full board meeting. We participated in two major street fairs in May and June, and for the very first time, we participated in the Roosevelt Island Day. And a good time was had by all. We view this as one of the best ways for community outreach and recruiting of new members. We will continue to have a strong presence at our two remaining street fairs in September, and we're looking for more participation from our newer board members, just to get out and get to know the community. Day-to-day, the Second Avenue subway construction finishes up above ground, with more and more trucks leaving and the housing's coming down. And retail business is currently improving. Our current issue is city bikes. Our transportation committee held a few forums on the city bike issue. The public came out in droves to voice public opposition to locations of these docking stations. In areas where there's strong opposition, they're looking for alternative locations. At the last transportation committee meeting, which Jim Clowns, our chair, suggested that the city bikes form a partnership with the owners of certain parking garages on the Upper East Side and perhaps locate the docking stations within parking garages in areas where there has been strong opposition. And also, we're also exploring the possibility of having speed bumps installed in bike lanes to slow down and prevent accidents between bicycles and pedestrians.
Thank you for that. Community Board 9?
Yes, good morning.
Good morning.
First of all, I'd like to thank you all. It's been a pleasure working with all of you for the past 4 years. This will be the end of my term, June 30th. I was nominated by our community board, however, to run for first vice chair unopposed. So from time to time, hopefully I will come back and be a part of these meetings. But we will be having our elections tonight, and we will have a new community board chair. We've got three great candidates. So we're excited. Our board has made a lot of progress, and we're really excited about what's on the horizon for us in the future. Real quick, we had our multicultural festival on May 30th, which was a huge success. We thank the Borough President's office for partnering with us to make it such a great success. And then we had our text amendment presentation to our executive board members last week. We are very, very concerned about what's going on with the new text amendments because our board spent over 4 years working on rezoning. And so we were excited initially because we're always looking for affordable housing. But now we have some concerns. And so we will be hosting a public hearing within the next month regarding the text amendment so we can have community come in and have input. We are, we have not been focused on the helicopters as much as we were. I don't see George.
It sounds like you're going to now.
But yes. unfortunately, our board member, who that was her passion, Catherine Abate, passed away, and we haven't had anybody who's really kind of picked it up. So I'll be talking to the chair of the committee because we should really continue the work and the fight that we were doing on that front. And we would certainly reach out to you.
What I failed to mention is we believe that there's more helicopters taking off on landing at this heliport than anywhere else in the country, mm-hmm. any non-military. So it might be the most dense.
And they're flying over our district.
They're flying over. Mm-hmm.
So, and then the last thing I want to speak about is the fact that we have so many buildings that are still in the TIL process that have not completed that process, and we are really concerned and worried at this point. And so a major focus of our Housing and Land Use Committee will be to make sure we reach out to all of the HDFCs in our community as well as the TIL buildings so that we can make sure that we secure them and that we don't lose that affordable housing, especially at this time when we're already on the brink of not, having any new affordable housing to our resource. We really fear for some of our buildings because we found out that they have major tax issues. So that will be a big concern and a big focus of CB9. Thank you. The TIL.
TIL.
Interim.
And we'll be looking at how to help our HDFCs make sure that they are in compliance with their taxes. Because we're hearing and some of the buildings have voiced some concerns. And then there was an article in DNA just, I think while I was abroad, someone told me there was an article. And so this is a reality. We don't want any of these buildings foreclosed on. And at this point in time, there is, of course, a push to foreclose on any that can be because it allows developers to come in and develop additional luxury housing. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your service. Yeah. I know you've left your board. You reinvigorated the board. You mentored a lot of new leadership, and you've left the board stronger than you found it. So that's really encouraging. Thank you so much. Community Board 10?
Yeah, Judge, on that note with the TIL houses, I don't know if they have anything in policy in place that those apartments can't be sold, because that's what's happening also. Individuals who've received those so-called affordable apartments, mm-hmm. people are coming in groves into the community and buying those apartments mm-hmm. for extraordinary money. So that's the other thing where they are leaving affordability because of that. So that's something you need to, we need to look into.
We passed a resolution that had language in it about those apartments not being sold.
Yeah, there have been several of them in our area that's been
sold.
Right,
because that was happening in our district as well.
Yeah, okay, great. Thank you. The first thing I want to talk about 2 weeks ago, there was a press conference on SEPTA City Hall that the Borough President participated in and sponsored, along with me and Anil Georgette, Congressman Rangel. Actually, Congressman Rangel's office is the one who initiated this because he was getting so many emails and letters, including from my board, I did one, saying we just have to look at this affordable housing in our community because it's one thing that all these new developments are being built, and this is great. The area is really popping, as the kids would say. But we're losing people. I got that from my little grandniece.
It's a technical term.
Popping. But what we're doing, we're losing because people can't afford to live in these houses. Landlords are taking over buildings, and before you know it, people are being asked to leave. So we really have to, we've come mm-hmm. together to say we've got to do something. So we formed a group, and I think the third meeting is tomorrow morning. to, I mean, even looking at putting a moratorium on a development, because it's happening so fast, and no one's looking out for the people who've been in these communities all these years and kept these communities alive. They just can't afford to live there, and I'm sure once, God forbid, I'm gone, or something, my apartment is gone, you know? I mean, so it's those kind of things we really have to stop and say, what's happening? We love what's happening in terms of development, but we've got to say, stop. Something is wrong here with this picture, even though I know everyone is doing things to make affordable housing, but I applaud you if you know the affordable houses in your community, because that's one of the things he's been talking about. No one knows where these affordable apartments are, who's getting them. When we do the 2080, that's the biggest concern. How are they getting these apartments? So we just don't know. So we formed this group, and hopefully we'll come up with something. But understand, it's not about building, you know, we're not against building high rises and everything like that. But folks in our community cannot afford to move into those apartments, and that's a big problem. And they're being pushed out because landlords are taking over the buildings that they're in. So that's one. Two, Harlem Business Workshop, the mayor's community affairs unit is hosting a workshop for businesses because, again, we have so many new businesses in our community now, and the noise level has just gotten a lot of the condo owners and our residents really uptight, you know, with the bars and everything like that, and we love all these bars, but the noise level. So the community affairs unit has come to us to ask us to help sponsor this Harlem Business Workshop, where they're going to be bringing sanitation in, DEP, the police department, and SLA to talk about this. And so this is going to be on June 30th. So I'll make sure that everyone gets a copy and of the notice and everything like that, and see what they can do about that. I think some of the businesses are being sued by some of the residents, and it's been a big thing. And, you know, so this is why the community affairs unit's doing this, and I'm very pleased that finally they reached out to us representing the mayor. So with that, I invited Elise Beal to meet with me Monday, because this is the first time, maybe the second time, they've come to us with something. You know, they have just kept their hands off as far as Community Board 10, never letting know what is going on when they're coming into the community to do something. So I just want to basically sit down with her and see how can we work out open bar lines of communication with the mayor's office, because right now it has not been good. We're hosting a gang and cruise workshop forum, actually, next Tuesday. And so our public safety committee is doing this because of all the problems that have been having with the, you know, the gangs and the crews. I mean, gangs and crews, I think they're the same thing, but I'm not sure. But so we're having this public hearing forum, rather, and that's going to be next Tuesday. And I think, Walter, you plan to come up at some point?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay, great. And let's just the last thing, our Department of City Planning is coming to us tonight, a land use, to talk about the planned rezoning as it relates to CB10, and we plan to do something like a little public hearing there. We've done one public hearing already, but this will be a second with City Planning there when they talk about the rezoning. And like you, we did a lot on 125th Street rezoning, and some of this may undo some of the things that's been happening, and we just need to make sure right now, I don't know where we stand on it. We will, you know, stand on this. We will see tonight after the presentation.
Thank you.
So that's it for me right now, okay?
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Jessica Mates, you had a related point?
Yeah, I just wanted to follow up. There is a meeting tomorrow morning, and we want to thank Community Board 9 and 10 for participating. We're going to have some, I think, really terrific information about TOE and HDFCs that are in the area, about where the affordable housing is, where kind of, you know, the sort of soft sites are. So, you know, we're looking forward to really identifying, getting a lot of information out and coming up with some really concrete suggestions for moving forward, both preserving what exists now, but also seeing what we can do moving down the road. So,
great.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to just tomorrow morning here.
Thank you. Community Board 11, Matthew Washington.
Sure. A few things. First, I want to thank the CB11 contingent that's here this morning, our district manager, assistant district manager, and one of our members, Nelsa, came out today. Very interested to hear about the new process for district needs and budget requests. So they're all here, which is great. A few things that I wanted to mention. I want to thank the Borough President's Office for hosting the second police community forum. It was held in East Harlem. It was wonderful. A lot of thanks certainly to the borough president, to Aldrin, Jessica, Jesus, and everyone who participated. Also, Henrietta Lyle showed up, and Bob Gormley. I want to thank them for participating. But just really a great conversation with members of the police department, as well as activists, youth, and just organized extremely well. There were so many people, we actually had to have people outside of the space at a table outside, which in retrospect was probably the coolest table.
But it was the one moderated by Gail.
But it was a great conversation, and people have continued to talk about that conversation after the forum took place, but an opportunity for officers and youth and activists to talk about some of the issues that we're dealing with and how we work collaboratively as a community to move forward. I know there will be a next forum in the Lower East Side, and so I think they're great. I would encourage those, even if it's not happening within your board, to attend them. I think they're very useful and very helpful in terms of the overall conversation about how we build and work on relationships with the police and within the community. Also want to give another shout out to Bob Gormley. Community Board 11 is working on going digital, and we've taken a lot of knowledge and information from Bob. Community Board 2 has been using tablets at full board meetings to have information, and so we've just ordered some, so it's something that we're going to introduce at CB11. I really want to thank Bob for all of his tips and talking with our staff about the operation of it, how we can handle that, so we're looking forward to just having everything look cleaner and not have everyone with a bunch of papers at every board meeting, so that's happening. Also, the last point, going back to February, the mayor's state city address, he talked about rezonings and identified East Harlem as a community that's going to be rezoned. The Speaker of the City Council has initiated a community engagement process in neighborhood planning, which we are actively working in. Certainly have been able to lean on the Land Use Division of the Borough President's Office quite a bit for a lot of support and insight into this process. But we're looking right now at the entirety of the community. With that effort alone, I think right now we have 6 public meetings scheduled in July and August, so we're going to keep busy working on this throughout the summer, but a lot of people are interested to see what's going to happen. The mayor's talked about building big, which isn't necessarily the greatest thing for low-income communities, so it's something that we are actively engaged in and will continue to work through and push forward and make sure that while we certainly know the administration has citywide goals, the real push is to address the needs of the immediate community, and to the degree that they fall in line with citywide goals, that's great, but their specific community needs are to be addressed. So it's something that we will be working on, something that we are actively engaged in and want to make sure the right thing is done for our community.
Thank you for the update. Will Colgrove, you had a related comment?
Yeah, a note on community boards going digital and sort of the move to paperless/tablet-based functionality for boards. So a couple of boards have approached me about both using their website and this idea of maybe updating their website to do better communications internally and externally, and also the idea of doing more with tablets and going to paperless meetings. One note on that front, so Microsoft, as some of you may know, is actually going to be moving their flagship retail store to Fifth Avenue on 54th Street coming soon. Microsoft is actually going to come on June 26th. We'll send an email out. This just got confirmed. On June 26th at 11 a.m., directly following the Borough Service Cabinet meeting next Friday, to talk to boards about some of the efforts they'd like to do in providing hardware and software support to community members, and we're trying to get them to focus on community boards to achieve some of those goals. So please, we'd love to have representation from every board, if possible, to talk to Microsoft about some of the ways they can be helpful, again, in providing hardware and software to boards to work on some of this functionality. So June 26th, 11 a.m., please come out and hopefully we can.
Are you going to be sending an email?
Yeah, we'll send an email out.
And it's directly after the borough service? Okay, good. So many district managers, all district managers will be here. Yeah. Great.
We will all be here.
Yeah.
We will all be here.
Yeah.
Are they coming here?
Oh, yeah, they're coming here. Yeah. So directly after borough service cabinet.
Oh, we're going to be here. Directly after.
I'll
Palmer, remember the district manager made a request to remain in the room after district service cabinet to discuss
District managers plan to have a meeting. After.
So maybe we could push back.
It's just a room. We have to figure out a room. You guys have to figure out a room.
But and the district manager, you guys, how long would you meet for?
We will be meeting for at least 2 hours, maybe three, to go over our questions and consultations.
Oh, wow.
Well, can we maybe the small conference room? I don't know if the small conference room is available.
Yeah, no, we can find another room for you, but I think the idea was that we wanted Microsoft to hear from you as well.
Yeah.
Okay.
So maybe we can do Microsoft. This meeting will not take long, and then we'll figure it out.
We can fit into the small conference.
I know, but we want a DM participation at the Microsoft.
Can I mean the front load on that? I talked about what Matthew was talking about with the tablets and CB2. I think it's happening. We all want it to happen. I think for this conversation on the 26th, maybe to help front load it, is one of the issues is board members are technically employees, and so we've just bought a bunch of tablets, and so we want to use them for certain committees. And that sometimes those committees go on for hours. And so then those folks take those tablets home with them, or that's the plan. And there's some operational issues that I think as technology gets more prevalent in our community boards, I think we need to I don't know who the agency that would be the one that stays or something, because they don't come into the board meeting.
I think those are
some of the operational things we got to be able to talk about, because that's what we're running into. When it's full board, it makes sense because you get them and then you get them back the same night. But with certain things in the interim,
please make sure you send Will Colgrove some of those concerns and copy me as well, and then we'll start collecting a lot of those concerns. I want to get to Community Board 12's update. Community Board 12.
Judge Fernandez is a bit under the weather, so this is a first for me, so I'll be as brief as possible. Today, between 12 and 10 and 2 p.m., we're having our job fair for particularly focused on our Spanish-speaking population. The Borough President's Office is co-sponsoring with us on that. Last Friday and Saturday, several community boards participated in the demystifying housing conference sponsored by Palante, and so that was a great session, and many of the politicians have showed up as well. I should say political electives showed up as well. And to continue the discussion with the police department and the relationship with ongoing with the community, the rollout of the Bill Bratton program for more community involvement, or the Neighborhood Community Officer program, the NCOs, started in our 3-3 and 3-4 precincts last week, and that seems to be going well. With their increased patrols, there is a direct dialogue with the officers. We have their phone numbers, their emails, they've been given tablets. They can check on any particular thing rather quickly, so the technology is there, and in effect, it's more street patrols and better involvement. So the Rockaways is the other area where that's being performed as well. NOMAR, our Northern Manhattan Arts Alliances, is having its Uptown Arts Stroll throughout the community, where major artists are exhibiting their work in various places and spaces. I encourage everyone to follow up on that, and that is posted on our website. We were very happy for the reopening of the High Bridge, and if you haven't been there, you should go see it.
It's amazing.
It's really amazing for everyone, and I think it opens up Northern Manhattan for a lot of other activities. We are still posting housing alerts on rent regulation, whatever updates occur, we will also post it on our Facebook account. So I believe that's all that I have to report, except for one other important thing. For the next board meeting, hope to pass a resolution for a street co-naming for the former mayor Dinkins, who has lived in our community for a very long time. And in effect, we are reserving that spot for him, and that's what will be presented at our next meeting.
Nice.
That's it.
Thank you.
Nice.
For in terms of borough president updates, thank you all for those of you who attended Monday's community board and all board reception that we had at the Museum of Natural History. To follow in the spirit of CBA, a good time was had by all. Lots of libation, and it was a really good time. As Matthew Washington mentioned, we've are on to our third police community relations dialogue, and it'll be in the Lower East Side. And then upon completion of that dialogue, we're going to come out with a report on different practice and policy and reform recommendations. So you can look forward to that. We also have a lot of summer projects happening. Right? We have the bylaws revision commission. We're going to have that. Soon you'll get an email on that. But we also have a project focusing on senior citizens. And so you, someone from our office, I believe they're here, is the intern. Can you can stand up and say your name?
Figure out what each community board, how they're dealing with senior issues, and I guess advancing on that.
Mm-hmm. So she's working closely with our, we have a senior citizen task force. We have a borough task force on seniors, and we're just about in completion of a senior resource guide as well soon. So to include into that and to help expand it, we like to get a sense of the different community boards. If you have a committee that just focuses on seniors, or if seniors are focused within which committee, and which have you developed your own resource guides, and then what are your special efforts in relation to that population? We want to make sure to include it in our resource guide, and just include it in our efforts. We also are concluding in the next 2 weeks the community board leadership series. We've had over 300 members from the community board, public members, prospective members, and also members of other boards participate in the trainings. Last night we had, for the first time, a hands-on open data-thon, if you will, where people brought their laptops and their tablets and really just started digging into these data sets a little bit more. And tonight we have, for the very first time, too, in recognition of the 50th anniversary of the landmarks legislation, we have a brand new training on landmarks. So everything A to Z in terms of what you like to know about landmarks. And we there's still openings in the remaining trainings, so we hope that you encourage your members to apply. We actually have our poster child, if you will, our poster community board member of community board trainings amongst us here, NILSA, who's taken, we've had 15, I believe, unique ones, and she's taken like 12. So she'll be getting her honorary master's degree in community board. So I remember, you know, when we did a tally of who took what training, we said, what? She took almost all of them. Like, that's pretty insane.
Last one,
so,
and I'll be
yeah, so we're really happy, and she's community board 11.
You have to stop making them so good. One of my members skipped the full board meeting and go to training.
We discourage that.
Yeah.
That's highly discouraged. That's no doing of our office. But so I know we have some council member reps. If you have any announcements, quick announcements on events or anything on the horizon. If not, we have a motion to adjourn.
So
second. Hearing no opposition, I imagine meeting adjourned. Thank you.